So I use a mix of Windows and Linux for various things, but I do also own a couple of Macs that I've used in the past for things like content creation tasks, video editing, recording, etc. Given my MacBook Pro is getting pretty old, it's actually a pre-Apple Silicon Intel version, and the new M4 devices provide excellent performance for those content creation tasks, so I decided to go ahead and buy a Mac Mini M4. Now, the base M4 Mini is actually great value in my opinion, and the M4 chip benchmarks really well. But as you almost certainly know, it comes with a really tiny onboard SSD. Upgrade prices for that are crazy. They are multiples of market prices for even higher-end consumer NVMEs. For example, a Gen 4 4TB TLC NVMe from someone like Samsung, Western Digital, or Lexar will run you somewhere in the range of maybe $250 to $300. Apple are going to charge you $800 just to go from 256GB up to 2TB. And for the base Mac Mini, 2TB is also the limit that you can install, where for off the shelf, you can get an 8TB NVMe for maybe $600 to $800. So I went ahead and I bought the base 256GB version, and I decided to go with external Thunderbolt storage to run everything on. And as I cover storage performance here on the channel, I tested all the options out to see which ones made the best sense. And there's going to be two videos below there for you to look at, if you're interested in this and want to check them out. There's one where I compare various 4TB NVMEs in a couple of different Thunderbolt 4 enclosures, but also where I do a deep dive on the performance of the Mac internal SSD itself. And it turned out that the onboard NVMe is pretty poor for performance also, but the outcome of all this is that I chose the Zeick Thunderbolt 4 enclosure and the Samsung 990 Pro 4TB SSD. And in total, this was half the price of a 2TB upgrade from Apple, and it provides better performance across the board, so you can go check those videos if you do want to see those numbers. But in this video, I'm going to show you the simple process to move your Mac life onto that external Thunderbolt enclosure. So this way you can stick with the base 256GB Mac, not pay the Apple tax, and what you're going to get turns out you're going to get much better performance than NAND that they use in the Mac. And this whole process actually only takes 10 minutes or so, and it is actually simple to do. And in this process, I cover configuring an entirely new Mac Mini, but also, once you're past those first couple of steps, it's really just the same process for an existing Mac where you already run your home drive and applications on an internal SSD. So let's get straight to it. So here we go. As we start up the new Mac, you do the basics here, like setting language, etc. And I'm just going to click past much of this. I don't tend to enable all of these things at this time or send my data to anyone. And this is true here, but also on Windows, etc. So like no Cortana, no Siri, you can all just get out of here. And to be clear here, we are not installing the OS on the external drive. And this is to ensure that if in the future we do run into any issues with the external drive, the OS is still bootable and it's possible to log in and fix any issues. But also certain features like Apple Intelligence do rely on that local drive hardware encryption. So the OS will go onto the internal disk as usual, and in the end, this probably ends up consuming only about 20GB or so of space. So I'm not going to sign into my Apple account or do any data migration. This can be done if you need to, but you should do it later. So first of all, we're going to set up a local user that we're not actually be using day to day. And this user will have their home drive on the internal disk, and it will again be done to ensure that should any problems occur in the future, you can always log in with this user without having any dependency on that external drive. So this user I'm going to call some admin user. Let's get them set up and logged in. And again, for this user, I'm not going to turn on any optional things like Siri or that rubbish. Okay, here we are. And first of all, some quick things that I'm going to need. First of all, disk utility. And I'm going to prepare my SSD drive and format using the APFS, which is the Apple file system. As mentioned, I'm using a Samsung 990 Pro 4TB SSD, and I'm putting it in this Zeick Thunderbolt 4 enclosure. And it's attached to one of those Thunderbolt 4 ports at the back of the unit. I'm going to provide links below to the items I'm using, which are the ones I decided were best based on that testing from the previous video. I did test other enclosures that worked well, but what I like about the Zeick is it's fanless, and I wanted to avoid that fan noise. So let's create a users folder now and an applications folder on that drive. And we're going to use these to store the majority of our data, getting this data off the internal SSD. Now we're going to get the terminal up also, and I'm going to set some finder settings here so we can see both my disks here on the desktop. And we can see that I have my default user and applications folder there on the internal disk, and now I have my new ones there on the external disk. So the first thing now is I'm going to create a symbolic link, and this is a pointer to the new applications folder on the external drive, and I'm going to place that link inside the default applications folder on the internal drive. Unfortunately, there isn't a native way to create these links in the user interface, such as through Finder, so you're going to need to use a terminal, but it is very simple, however. You just need to type ln space minus s, and then you type or drag the location of the folder or file you're linking to, and then after that you put where the link will be, and in this case, this is a source of just .slash, meaning it's going to be right here in this folder. And if we look in the default applications folder now, we can see our link, which takes us to the application folder up here. We're going to keep the existing applications for the fallback user, but also it isn't really viable to move it due to just how the OS treats this folder. However, the plan here is not to use the internal applications folder going forward, and we're going to be putting new applications into the folder on that external drive. And you can see here that the link creates a pointer from the default folder to our new folder. Okay, next, let's go create a new user that we'll use for all future activities. In this case, this user is going to be called Some Tech Guy, and I'm going to set them as an administrative user. So once we do this, we will see a home drive going to be created for them on the internal drive users folder. And at this point, we're in a similar situation as you would be if this wasn't the clean install. You have an existing user that you use, and the user folder already exists on the internal disk. So from here on in, you can consider this the process for migrating on an existing Mac that you're using today. So next, let's move this folder to the users folder on the external disk. And before I do this, I'm just going to browse to this folder, and I'm going to press the Command Shift period keys together. And as you can see, what this does is it just makes sure that all hidden folders are and files are shown. And this just means I can make sure that everything is moved or copied. And like I say, you do have the option here to just copy the folder if you want to. But for me, the goal is to release that space on the internal disk. And obviously it's a new user, so I'm just going to move the entire folder. And I think it's also probably good to say at this point that, you know, if you're doing this with an existing user, having a backup is always wise before you make any changes like this. It's always better to have a backup and not need it than need a backup and obviously not have it. Okay, next, let's repoint the user to this new location for the home drive. And we do this by browsing over to the external disk and selecting the Some Tech Guy folder inside the user management dialog. And then we can hit OK to submit this change. And now the home folder points here to the external disk. Okay. So the next job now is to reboot the Mac. I think you're going to find if you just switch users at this point, you may find the login just hangs for your new user. So a reboot is the best bet here. And if you do just click switch users and it does hang, you can just reboot the Mac and that should resolve that issue straight away. Okay, so now let's log back in with my new Some Tech Guy user. And we will have to set the profile up for this user also. So it's the usual click pass and set up the user profile. Now, if we open up the two disks, again, we can see the user's home folder is now over here on the external disk. Now, let's go and set up the App Store. And this is to configure to point the application folder to the external disk also. Unfortunately, Apple doesn't provide an option for all downloads or all applications to go in this folder, but rather just apps over a rather arbitrary 1 gigabyte in size. Now, this will catch the big apps, of course, and are going to have the most impact to disk usage. But we are going to deal with the smaller one shortly, so let's set that now. Now let's go and install an app that's going to be smaller than 1 gigabyte. And for example, Amorphous Diskmark here. This will download, and as you can see, it's less than 1 gigabyte, and it's going to go back into the default folder on the internal drive. And if we click up here on the applications folder, we see it here. So let's either move or copy this app over to the external apps folder now. And if we install a larger app, for example, here I'm installing Motion, we can see it installs directly to the external drive. So what we have here is a simple and straightforward way to move the user folder and the application folder to the external drive so that the vast majority of data intensive tasks are going to end up on the external SSD and not consuming space on that internal drive. So another thing to think about here is that external app folder, actually apps in there won't automatically appear in Launchpad. But for apps that you do want in there, you can also just create a symbolic link again on the internal applications folder pointing back to the application that's in that external disk. And they will then immediately show up on Launchpad as well, as you can see. And again, this is just ln space minus s, followed by the location of the actual app on your external disk, and then where the link will be, e.g. in the slash applications folder. And to see what this means, just starting out and before we really start to use the Mac, we can look at the disk usage now for the users folder on the internal disk versus that of the external, and again the same for the applications folder. And we can see that the base user has around 765 megabytes, which shouldn't change much going forward, as we're not going to be using that user at all for anything, but that the user on the external disk already has about 1.3 gigabytes used. And it's the same on the applications, with the internal disk currently using 500 megabytes and the external disk already using 20 gigs. And a couple of notes on things that people have commented on about external drives, because I have heard it said that there can be problems with sleep and external drives, with either maybe the disk getting ejected during sleep or with the drive even preventing sleep from working properly. But I have not seen any of these problems. For example, my test unit Mac pulls about 11 to 13 watts at the wall when it's idling. And then when put to sleep, this drops to 2.6 watts and it stays that way consistently. It also seems the Mac has no problem putting the drive into lower power mode as the drive power and access light goes down and the enclosure does noticeably cool when it's sleeping. So when woken, there's also no problems with the disk getting ejected and it's immediately accessible. There was one proposed fix, and that is to ensure that you select put hard disk to sleep when possible to never under power settings. But this isn't an option on my Mac. I'm guessing it's a MacBook thing. And I have no problems with lower power mode being enabled or disabled. I don't know if this is really an issue, or maybe it's just something that's associated to MacBooks, but please, you know, go ahead, share your comments below if you've seen this or if you have a problem with this or not. I think it'll be interesting for others to understand. So thank you. Please do the like thing. It was useful, and subscribe for more content. It's hugely appreciated. Mostly I cover storage and home compute topics for enthusiasts, but I also have more content coming on both Mac storage solutions, but also there's going to be a lot more SSD performance and testing comparisons, and of course, more hard disk testing. I have a load here of desktop, surveillance, NAS, and enterprise drives that I'm currently testing, and that's all going to be coming to the channel. And until then, I will see you in the next.